have your way, Jesus. On every part, Jesus. Jesus.
Thank you. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you. Praise you. Just for who you are. Just because you're worthy. Bless you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Bless your name, Jesus. Praise and honor you. Father, we know that you're blessing us, but what we don't understand is how much we're blessing you. It almost seems, I don't know, Father, almost like it would be a little presumptuous of us to think that, you know, we can bless you because you're Almighty God. But yet, in your word, we see things like, I will bless the Lord at all times. That his praise shall continually be on my lips. So, Father, we have been blessed by blessing you tonight. It's fun to praise you and to worship you, Jesus. It's fun. Father, I pray right now that during our conference, there would be just a powerful atmosphere of praise and worship. That, Father, people who attend, who maybe have never really gotten involved in praise and worship, they're going to have a breakthrough in this conference. That, Father, something is going to happen in them. And that those who are already praisers and worshipers, Father, it'll just go to a higher level during our conference. Not so we can brag about what happened, but because of what we'll experience with you. We need it, Father. We need it. And I know it will only do us good. So I'm asking that even right now, between now and our conference, that you minister to all of us, but also to all the people who will be coming here. That, Father, there will be no hindrances. That folks will feel the freedom to come up front and to worship, to step outside of a comfort zone and enter into the glory zone. Father, I thank you. I thank you so much again for what you're doing here in our midst. And all the praise goes to you, Jesus. It's an honor to be born again. In your name, Lord, amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, guys, why don't you take a few moments and let some people know that you realize they are here. Well, let's pick up and continue from where we were this morning. Title of the sermon is Pride, Rebellion, and Destruction. To review very briefly from this morning, first thing that I did was share with you for a short time some of the responsibilities of a pastor. That a pastor is supposed to deliver truth, line upon line, precept upon precept. If you're a pastor and you are controlled by the dictates of a denomination, already you can't do that. You cannot, see, a pastor is supposed to seek God and deliver what God wants that pastor to deliver to that church. And so if you've got a denomination that says, okay, on Father's Day, you got to preach a Father's Day sermon. And they send it to you. You know, here's the outline for your father's. That goes on. A lot of people don't know this. But denominations will send pastors subject matter to preach on and sometimes outlines. And one of the reasons denominations do that is so that if people who are a member of that denomination are on vacation or whatever out of town, and they can go to a church of the same denomination, and they already know pretty much what they're going to hear. Well, next week's lesson is going to be, and so they know they'll be able to pick up on it. Well, I understand the thinking behind that, but, you know, a pastor ought to be seeking God. You know, what do you want me to deliver? What does this congregation need? And along with that, a pastor cannot control or change anyone. Now, parents, you ought to know this. You can tell your children to do whatever. And they're either going to do it or they're not. Now, you may have to threaten them with something to get them to do it. And in some cases, threaten all you want. They're still not going to do it. I heard a preacher one time talking about, two kids and, his two kids. And one kid was just, you know, please mommy and daddy, whatever they want and so forth. But the other child had a very distinct personality to where if the child didn't want to do it, child wasn't going to do it. And he shared one time how, you know, now I said, I think it was like clean your room or whatever. You know, I said you have to clean your room. Don't want to. I said you have to clean your room. Don't want to. Not going to. If you don't clean your room, you're going to get a spanking. Go ahead. Spank me. Because in the child's mind, yeah, pain endureth for a while. But joy cometh in the morning. Seriously. Well, what are you going to do with someone like that? Well, the same way in a church. You know, a pastor said, now don't do this. Now, don't you be doing that. Don't act that way in this church. And if a person's going to do it, they're going to do it. That's just the way it is. And some people, that is how they are. Born again, but you ever heard the phrase, you know, stubborn as a mule? People like that, you don't need them in your church. Because they are going to cause more problems than it's worth. You need to pray them out. Now, a pastor is supposed to nurture believers and exercise authority for edification, not destruction. Meaning, if there's correction necessary, well, the correction needs to take place, but it's for the good of that person. You know that old adage, you know, parents getting ready to spank the child, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you. I don't think so. You won't be crying. I'm the one that's going to be screaming and yelling. But we understand the concept. And the Bible even says, whom the Lord loves, he chastens. Now, he doesn't spank people and, you know, well, you were bad today. I'm going to burn your house down. That's not how God works. You know, some people seem to think that's how he works, but that's not how he works. But he does chasten. Now, we saw an example in the Old Testament of Saul when he was a king. And God had given him instructions, and Saul was not supposed to be offering up sacrifices, but Samuel didn't do what Saul thought Samuel should do, so he offered up sacrifices, and Samuel shows up and says, what are you doing? And Saul says, well, you know, we got an enemy here, and somebody's got to do something, and you weren't here, so I offered up a sacrifice to God. Well, the casual observer might think, well, what's the big deal? I mean, he offered a sacrifice to God. That shouldn't be a problem, but it was a problem because that's not the way God said to do it. See, you can do something with good motives, but if the something you do is out of order concerning the will of God, you're wrong. Well, we saw another incident with Saul. How that God said, all right, I want you to go in and I want you to deal with the Amalekites and I want you to kill everything that breathes. From the king on down, all the people, all the animals. Kill them until they are dead. Just kill them all. And so Saul says, okay, we can do that. So he goes in and they kill all of the sick animals and all the people except for Agag, and they kept the good animals alive. Well, Samuel shows up and Saul says, hey, Samuel, good to see you, buddy. You remember the last time that you said that I had not obeyed the commandment of the Lord? Well, guess what, dude? I obeyed this time. And Samuel says, well, if that's the case, then why do I hear all these animals over here? And Saul said, oh, well, let me tell you. See, we went in and we killed all the people, just like we're supposed to. And we killed all the, you know, sick animals and, you know, the ones that, you know, nobody wants them. But the good animals we kept so we could sacrifice them unto God. And Samuel says, you don't get it. You know, God wants you to obey more than he wants you to sacrifice. You think you're doing the right thing, but no. See, you're in rebellion, Saul. You're in rebellion to the word of God. Now, to the casual observer, they might think, well, now, wait a second. God wants sacrifices. That's in the law. Why would you get so mad about him trying to do what God wants? Because that's not what God wanted. Yes, the animals were supposed to die, but not on the sacrificial altar. They were supposed to die when the Israelis, the Jewish army, attacked and killed. I mean, that's when they were supposed to die. And then the thing about Agag, well, you know, Samuel took care of that because he grabbed a sword and hacked Agag to pieces. That's gross. So we saw this example of Saul and how it can look like you're doing the right thing, but you're really not doing the right thing if you're not doing it the way God said to do it. And we saw several verses in Proverbs about pride, saw in Exodus about being stiff-necked. And then we saw over there in Ezekiel 28, one of the primary reasons why God gets so upset over pride and arrogance and the uplifted heart and so forth. It's because that is what led to Lucifer being kicked out of heaven for all eternity. The pride in him got to the point to where he says, well, I'm going to have a throne like God's. I'm going to sit up there with God. I'm going to be exalted. I'm going to be, it's me, it's me. And God said, no, no, you're a created being. You're not the creator. And you'll never be the creator. Therefore, you have permanently stained yourself, and I have to kick you out. God didn't want it to be like that, but that's the path that Lucifer chose. Now we know him as Satan. Well, it's the same thing for Christians. We live in a society today that has fostered rebellion and pride against God. It's all about me. It's what I want. I want the liberty and the freedom to do what I want. It's gotten worse. I mean, the pride's always been there. All throughout history, you can see it all throughout the Bible. Satan is always working on people to get them involved with pride. Every person who calls this their home church, Satan is working to try to get you caught up in pride. Now, that doesn't mean you're yielding to it, as I mentioned this morning, because we can resist this, and I try to be very sensitive to it. You know, questioning my motives. You know, like I told you before how I prayed, God, I want the church to grow, and he asked, all he said was, why? Why? And so, man, I stopped right there and started thinking about me. Okay, well, why do I want the church to grow? Bragging rights? You know, why we're up to like 15 services a day? Why you want to see that parking lot? Trust me, we're not going to 15 services a day. But you get the idea. I sit back and evaluate myself, and quite honestly, I think there are times when I go before God and apologize for things that maybe I don't have to apologize for, but I'd rather be safe than sorry. Anyway, pride leads to your destruction. In fact, pride can result in your destruction, and you don't even know it. You don't even realize it, because pride has a numbing effect on a person's spiritual senses. If Lucifer had known, I mean, if he had recognized what was going on as he began, as that cancer of pride began growing on the inside of him, if he had realized, I mean, here's the thing. I'm sure God did what he could to get it across to him. I'm sure God didn't sit back and just wait until one day it's like, okay, come here, Lucifer. Dude, you're out. Well, what'd I do? Well, you've been in a rebellion. No, I have no doubt, but what, I don't want to even go off on a tangent on this, but I, listen, God's not going to let anybody be destroyed without giving them warnings. And that's part of what this series, or this, not this series, but this sermon this morning and tonight, it's all about. It's giving people a warning. And there are a lot of folks out there. Look, this church, this is not a bad church. This is a good church. You got some churches out there, good heavens. Everybody in the church needs to hear this, because they're messing up. You know, there was a church down in Georgia. I shared this with you. Church down in Georgia where the pastor stood up. Now, this is a you must be born again church, okay? The pastor stood up and he said, now, folks, look, you know, we're not going to have division among people. These doors are open to anybody. It doesn't matter who you are. And it doesn't matter what your skin color, this church is open to everybody. Blacks are going to be welcome in this church. Guess what? They fired him because of that. Well, now, wait a second. I thought the pastor was supposed to be in charge. Obviously, he wasn't. Obviously, he's under the thumb of other people. And that's the way it is in a lot of denominations. They do not recognize the authority of the pastor. And so they have group rule. Now, group rule is mayhem. Because, hey, listen, if you've never been in a group rule church business meeting, you have no idea. I mean, it can come to blows. Seriously. They don't even go out in the parking lot. It's just right here, right in the sanctuary. Bam, pow. You know, like that old Batman TV show. You know, the pow words. And anyway. Moving right along. Turn to Jude. I'd tell you chapter 1, but that's kind of redundant because you don't have too many choices over there. Jude, chapter 1. Now, we're not going to read this whole book, but in Jude, beginning in verse 4, he says, "For there are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." Now stop right there. I'm not going to go into a massive amount of detail in this, but it wasn't that they were saying there is no such person as Jesus Christ. See, when you teach something that is in opposition to what God has recorded in his word, then you are denying Jesus. Because he said, my words stand. That's just the way it is. The word of God stands. You're not going to change it. And this whole thing about, you know, the creeping in unawares and so forth, this is talking about in the church, rising up within the church. Well, go ahead and jump over to verse 8. "Likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed not about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation." That phrase, railing accusation, in part means a condemning sentence. So see, you can't condemn. You know, a lot of people say, "You devils, you stop doing what you're doing here, and I command you in the name of Jesus to go back to hell where you came from." You can't do that. Well, yes, no, you can't. Well, yes, no, you can't. You can't do that. You cannot bring a railing accusation against a demon. Did Jesus? Come on now. Did Jesus? No. I can see your eyeballs are spinning. Well, I don't know. I'm not sure. No, he cast them out. Remember what the one demon said? "Have you come to torment us before the appointed time? Have you?" He said, "No, that day's coming, but right now, come out of him. Come out of him." Jesus didn't even release unto them a condemning sentence. You can't do that. You can cast them out, but you don't have that authority. You know who's got that authority to send them to hell? Jesus. All right? And you're not Jesus. So he says, he didn't bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally, as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for a reward, and perished in the gainsaying of... Now, this next person who's identified here, in some King James Bibles, it is spelled C-O-R-E. In some, it's K-O-R-A-H. Now, I don't know which you're looking at, but C-O-R-E comes from the Greek rendering of the Hebrew name K-O-R-A-H, Korah. Same person, no difference. Exact same person. If you have a marker, put it right here in Jude. We'll come back in a moment. So the question is, what is the gainsaying of Korah? Well, this word gainsaying, it comes from a Greek word, antilogia. And what it means is to contradict, a contradiction, a rebellion, strife. In other words, it's a rising up. And notice it's translated as gainsaying. Okay, think of it kind of like this relative to this verse. What I am saying is for my personal gain and exaltation. See that? Gainsaying. And it is in opposition to that which is truth. All right, now let's find out, since he's mentioning Korah, let's find out what did Korah do. Turn back over to Numbers chapter 16. Now, in Numbers chapter 16, we're not going to go through the entire chapter. We're going to hit some highlights relative to what happened. And then we're going to go back to Jude. So here in Numbers chapter 16, it says, verse 1, now Korah, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of, who's that next person? Levi. Who was Levi? Levi was one of the heads of one of the 12 tribes. And the tribe of Levi was the what? Tribe of the Levitical priesthood. That means that Korah is a member of the Levitical priesthood. So the son of Levi and Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and On, the son of Peleth, sons of Reuben, took men. What that means is they gathered some people together. Now, what you're reading here did not just happen overnight. This is something that was going on. How do we know that? Look here. And they rose up before Moses with certain of the children of Israel, 250 princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown. So what's happened is these guys in verse 1 have been meeting, call it secretly if you will, with the 250 men of importance among the nation of Israel. And they've been talking and talking and talking until finally they get to the place, it's like, you know what? That's it. Last straw. We need to go talk to Moses and just straighten some things out here. And so they're all in agreement. How do you know? Because they all showed up. So you've got over 250 people, men, leaders. And it says in verse 3 that they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron and said unto them, ye take too much upon you, seeing all the congregation are holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Wherefore then lift ye up yourselves above the congregation of the Lord. In other words, who do you think you are to put yourself in a position of authority over everybody? I mean, you know, who are you anyway? And Moses heard it and fell on his face, and he spake unto Korah and all his company, saying, even tomorrow the Lord will show who are his and who is holy, and will cause him to come near unto him. Even him whom he hath chosen will he cause to come near unto him. Now stop right there. In this situation, these men are not people that everybody else in the nation of Israel was saying, you better watch out for those guys. Oh, no, no. They put on a good front. And they gained the respect of the people of Israel. So that when they went to Moses, they had what could be perceived as clout. And they say, who do you think you are? Hey, you know what? God is among all of us. Why, we're all chosen. Why, we're God's special people. And, you know, we just don't think it's right for you to lift yourselves up over us. Well, for one thing, Moses didn't lift himself up above anybody. I mean, let's think about this, Korah and all your buddies. Who was it that went before Pharaoh? Who was it that put his own life on the line in Pharaoh's court to try to get all of you released from the bondage of Egypt? Who was it that led you over there to, you know, to the waters and the waters receded and parted and dried land? And I mean, who did this? Who stood there with his staff and got you set free? Who did this? Well, these guys seem to have, now listen to this, they seem to have forgotten that Moses and Aaron had the call of God upon their lives. That call does not mean the person is perfect. It means that person has been chosen of God for a purpose. Well, Moses tried to get this all worked out, but they wouldn't have anything to do with it. So, Moses, the next day, calls all the people together and he says, now look, verse 29. If these men die the common death of all men, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord hath not sent me. Meaning, like if they die of old age or whatever else, you know, get in a car wreck or something. But if the Lord make a new thing, and the earth open up her mouth and swallow them up with all that appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit, then you shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord. Meaning, they rose up against me, they challenged me, but they were provoking the Lord. I'm not here on my own. In fact, if you remember, Moses actually argued with God about leading Israel out. He goes, God, I can't even talk right. You need to get somebody else, blah, blah, blah. And he made God mad. Well, finally, Moses figured out, not good to make God mad. So I think I'll go do this. Well, he says, folks, you need to understand something. They've come against me, but they have provoked the Lord. Well, it came to pass, as he made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground cleaved asunder that was under them, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up and their houses and all the men that appertained unto Korah and all their goods. They and all that appertained to them went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them, and they perished from among the congregation. And all Israel that were round about them fled at the cry of them, for they said, lest the earth swallow us up also. And there came out a fire from the Lord and consumed the 250 men that offered up incense. And then it goes on to tell what happened from that point on. In other words, you know, Korah and his little group began to have an influence on the 250. And the 250 men of responsibility, men of renown, men of authority, men who had the admiration of the people, began listening to Korah and says, you know what? He's got a point. We all got set free. And Korah is from the tribe of Levi. I mean, you know, really, who does Moses think he is? I've seen the guy. You know, sometimes he gets a little temperamental. I've seen him. He, he's kind of old anyhow. I don't know. Why should he be the guy in charge? Maybe we should vote. Well, God said, that's it. You're rising up against the person that I called and appointed to be over this entire group of people. And I'm not going to stand back and let this happen. And those people were destroyed. That's what rebellion will do to you. See, if let's say you have a Christian, somebody goes to a church, and in that church, the pastor tells people, well, if they don't tithe, they're going to die and go to hell. All right, that's not right. What if the pastor says, healing is not for today. The gifts are not for today. Once you get born again, you get all the Holy Ghost there is to get. I mean, on and on and on it goes. Now, even though that pastor may be, he's telling people they need to be born again, but he may be totally wrong on many other areas of doctrine, you better not start congregating with other people and bad-mouthing that pastor, because God honors that seat of authority. And God is honoring that pastor. You better not. In fact, if any of you here, any of you listening to this, and any of you watching this, have ripped your pastor, I mean, just gone after it, you bless God, better drop to your knees and repent. Now, I mean it. You better repent, because you're wrong. And you're on a path to hell if it doesn't change.
Well, he ain't going to send me to hell, because I know the pastor's wrong.
Hey, it's not about the pastor being right or wrong. It's about you honoring that person in that place of authority. I can tell you right now, I know. There are people who would hear this and just get all upset with me.
But you just don't understand.
I do understand. It's like I shared this morning. If I go into another church, I'm under the authority of that pastor. I must subject myself to that pastor. Even if I have more clarity concerning doctrine in certain areas than maybe what that pastor does, I still have to be in subjection to that pastor. And woe be to me if I start running my mouth and discrediting that pastor. I mean, just going to say, you know, your pastor, he's wrong about this stuff. This isn't right. Why are you people putting up with this? You follow what I'm saying? I know you do. You better be cautious about this. Very, very cautious. God's warned about it. But now let's see another side to this, another perspective. Turn over to Acts. Acts chapter 9. Now in Acts chapter 9, this is the story of the Apostle Paul who has that encounter with Jesus. And, you know, you're wondering about this, and God is that serious about it, and you're not accepting it. This is not me just tooting my horn. I told you this morning, and I repeated it tonight. You know, I can't control you, and I can't make you change, but I'm telling you right now, I'm called of God. And I'm the pastor of this church, and you better not run your mouth against me. And this is for your own sake. I can handle it. Good glory to God. If you only knew what people have said about me. I can handle it. I'm concerned for you. Look, I'm saying this because somebody somewhere is having an issue here. Well, I'm just going to warn you. It wasn't long after I came into this church as the pastor, God moved on me and I gave a word that somebody needed to repent. And if they didn't, they were going to die. They didn't repent. 30 days later, they dropped over dead in their uncle's front yard. Dropped over dead. Young guy in his 30s. So I'm telling you now. See, it's one thing if people haven't heard this kind of a message, but it's another thing once you've heard it. You better get it right between you and God. Hey, I don't live for your apology. Now, if I lived for apologies, dear Lord, people be lined up out the door. I don't live for your apologies. And I don't walk in unforgiveness. But I'm telling you, it's not right. Now, the Apostle Paul, he has the encounter with Jesus, you know, Damascus Road, and gets saved, gets filled with the Holy Ghost. And if you pick this up in verse 19, it says, "And when he, Paul, had received meat and was strengthened, then was Saul, later he became Paul, certain days with the disciples which were at," where? Damascus, okay? "And straightway he," Saul, "preached Christ in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. But all that heard him were amazed and said, is not this he that destroyed them which called on this name in Jerusalem and came hither for that intent that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. And after that many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. But their laying await was known of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and led him down by the wall in a basket. In other words, they helped him sneak out. And when Saul was come to where? Jerusalem. He attempted to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. Well, he finally convinced them. Barnabas said, look, he's okay. Verse 30, which when the brethren knew, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him forth to Tarsus because, well, verse 29, he spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus and disputed with the Grecians, but they went about to slay him. And so the disciples said, okay, look, this is getting a little out of hand. Saul, your zeal is admirable. We appreciate your salvation. However, things are getting a little difficult around here. Tell you what, go to Tarsus. Just go to Tarsus. And so what did Saul do? He went to Tarsus. All right, now turn over to Acts chapter 11. Between Acts chapter 9, what we just read, and what we're getting ready to read in Acts chapter 11, a minimum of 8 years has passed. Now, depending upon which historian you read, it could be 9 years, it might be 10, it might be 11, but it's a minimum of 8 years have passed. And so in Acts chapter 11, verse 19, now, they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phinehas and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but unto the Jews only. And some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which, when they were come to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus. Verse 25. Then departed Barnabas to where? Tarsus. Where was it that the disciples sent Saul back in chapter 9? To Tarsus. It's been how long? Minimum of 8 years. And so Barnabas goes to Tarsus to seek for Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him unto where? Antioch. And it came to pass that whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. Okay, now turn over to chapter 13. Between what we have just read and what we're getting ready to read in chapter 13, a minimum of 6 years has passed. Minimum. It might be seven, it might be eight, but it's a minimum of 6 years. So in Acts chapter 13, verse 1, where were we just a few moments ago? What city? Antioch. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers as Barnabas and Simeon that was called Niger and Lucius of Cyrene and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. As they ministered unto the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. Okay, what does this mean? Right here, chapter 13, verse 4, this is Paul's first missionary journey. From Acts chapter 9, go to Tarsus, until here, a minimum of 14 years has passed. And it could have been as many as like 17, but a minimum of 14 years. Okay, now, if anybody could have stood up and said, hey, I'm ready for this. Do you understand who I am? I am Saul turned Paul. I am the guy that used to kill you. I'm Damascus Road dude, all right? I'm now one of you. I know Jesus. You know how many years it's been since that event? You understand what I'm getting at? Could have happened that way, but it didn't. He stayed right there in Tarsus until Barnabas shows up and says, okay, we think it's time now. Would you please come with me? And he did. And he spent some time there in Antioch. And then he gets sent out. The Holy Ghost sent him forth. God knew he was ready. Remember this morning we were talking about all of that cutting away that needs to be done? Apparently there was a lot of cutting away that needed to be done in Paul before God could send him on these journeys. But yet, Paul submitted to it. He let it take place. Now, this is a lesson. On the one hand, we have Korah, who rises up in rebellion.
I'm just as good as you.
But then on the other hand, we have the Apostle Paul. And he says, hey, listen, I'll stay in Tarsus for the rest of my life if need be. I'm just glad I'm saved. I'm just glad I'm born again. I'm just glad I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And yet, when the time came, he obeyed God, but he recognized the authority of other people. And he did not try to exalt himself. Now, you know this thing where Korah, it talks about the gainsaying of Korah back over there in Jude. That word gainsaying, as I shared, it's what I say for my gain. You could say it's related to self-exaltation, but now what Korah did, what he said, what's recorded back over there in the Old Testament and the Numbers, let me kind of paraphrase what he was saying. You're not the only one who can hear God. I can hear him too. My message is just as good as yours. It doesn't matter that you've been to the mountaintop with God and I haven't. Or it could be something like this. It doesn't matter that you've been touched by God's glory in a way that I haven't. Or it could be something like this. It doesn't matter that God has appointed you to be the leader. Do you follow this? Do you realize that what I've just shared, those statements, those variations on the theme of what Korah said, that is exactly what goes on in churches. I don't care if you're the pastor. It doesn't matter to me. Here's one thing interesting. Go back and read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And just try to find some place where everybody was calling him Jesus. Hey, Jesus, how you doing today, buddy? When people approached him, they said things like, Master, Rabbi. Now, even though a lot of them didn't mean it, still, they went through the formality of demonstrating respect. And you have people in churches today, they think, now, you got to pay attention to what I'm saying. They think they're just as good as the pastor. Well, you may be just as good as the pastor, but in the local church, you are not just as called. You may be called to be a pastor, but you're not pastoring in that church. You understand what I mean by that? So you are just as good as far as salvation and so forth is concerned. You can hear God. Absolutely, you can hear God. You can understand Scripture, so on and so forth. But you're not just as called in the local church. Whoever the pastor is in that church, you know, the assumption is God's the one that placed that person, although we know that's not always true. Still, in that local church, that individual is the pastor. And so that respect is supposed to be demonstrated to that pastor. Look over in Jeremiah chapter 3. In Jeremiah chapter 3, now this is prophetic, but in verse 15, God says, and I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. And then over in Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 3 through 4, he says, and I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all countries whither I have driven them, and will bring them again to their folds, and they shall be fruitful and increase. And I will set up shepherds over them which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, saith the Lord. Again, prophetic, to keep it short and simple, God is saying, it is my intention to give you pastors who are going to feed you from my word. They're going to do what they're supposed to do. Well, the flip side to that is, okay, if you're not in submission to the leadership in the church, if you're not in submission to the authority of the pastor, I'll guarantee you what, you're not going to eat what's being fed. Now, that's assuming truth is being fed, but you won't. You simply won't. You know, you'll mush it around on your plate. You know how kids do, try to make it look like they've eaten when they really haven't. Look over in Matthew chapter 8. I'm going to give you an example here. This is kind of interesting. Matthew chapter 8. Now, here in Matthew chapter 8, just pick it up on verse 5. It says, "And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him, saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. Jesus says, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. I say to this man, go, he goes. I say to another, come, he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it." Now, Jesus makes the comment, man, I haven't heard anything like this, period, from anybody here in Jerusalem. But here's what's being portrayed. Those soldiers that he's talking about, I guarantee you not all of them fully understand what they were being told to do. All of them may not, well, I'm not sure that this is the right thing, but I mean, he's the centurion, so I better, since I'm under his authority, if he says go, I go. If he says come, I come. I have to. That's what I do as a soldier. That's what I've been trained to do. Well, see, in the body of Christ, Christians have not been trained to be in scriptural submission to the pastor. Now, there have been twistings of this to where the pastors have tried to ruin, have ruined people's lives, telling them who they can marry and who they can't marry, where they can live, where they can't live, what kind of car they can buy, so on and so forth. Those kind of things have gone on. But when it is the way it's supposed to be, the pastor is recognized by God, and the pastor recognizes what he can and can't do. He understands his limitations, but the people are supposed to respond to that respect. It's not a... See, as I'm standing here, I'm being reminded of all these examples that I just don't have time to go into. Well, see, it's not a matter of you having to bow your head every time I come by. I know of a situation where a person in leadership at a church told other people walking through the halls of the church, when the pastor comes by, you bow your head and you don't make eye contact. Now, the pastor wasn't like that. But the people, those others, more highly than they, you know, the Korahs in the church, they were kind of like that. When you understand that place that you hold within the church, see, it doesn't mean that God looks at anybody as being less than somebody else. It's a matter of being in line with God's word when it comes to submission to godly authority and not being in rebellion to it. Look over you're in Matthew, look in chapter 21. See, a lot of Christians, you know, they have this idea, you know, okay, yeah, pastor, you know, whatever it is, bless God, you know, I'm in agreement, I'm submitted. Well, they're in submission as long as they are in agreement. Well, it doesn't matter agreement or not. You're not going to like everything. I know that. Gee whiz, guys, come on. People are people. It's not a matter, you know, selective submission doesn't cut it in the kingdom of God. Now, Matthew 21. Look here, verse 1. And it says, when they, Jesus and the disciples, when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying to them, go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, the Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. Okay, now, that's what was said, correct? So here these disciples, they go into town to do what Jesus said. So now Jesus, he and the rest of the disciples are sitting around talking, and they hear this noise. And they turn and they look, and here come the two disciples, but they don't have the ass and the colt. What do they have? Why, they have a big cart, a big wagon, that is being pulled by two oxen. And Jesus looks at this, and man, those guys, they got big smiles on their face, and they walk up and say, Jesus, look at this. And Jesus says, what? Where's the ass and the colt? Jesus, wait till you hear. We went into town to get the ass and the colt, all right? But when we were talking to the man about the ass and the colt, we noticed right next to the ass and the colt, there's this wagon here with two oxen. And the guy that owned it was standing there, had his back to us. And so we went over and we asked him, say, excuse us, sir. And when he turned around, Jesus, it was the father of that little girl that you healed. Remember that the other day, the girl with the banged up leg and you healed her? Okay, it was him. It was daddy. And so we said, hey, look, you know, we're going to get this ass and this colt and take it to Jesus, you know, so he could have a ride. But, you know, you've got this wagon and the two ox. How much would you charge us to rent this so that Jesus could use it? And he said he wasn't going to charge a dime. Jesus, look at this. And now it's not just an ass and a colt. Now it's a wagon and two oxen. We can all fit in this. We all get to ride, Jesus. Isn't this cool? And those two disciples look at each other and boom, give a fist bump. Yeah, Jesus, we did it right, man. And what do you think Jesus is going to say?
Oh, boys, thank you so much. I hadn't thought about a wagon. Oh, my goodness.
No, he's probably going to say, take it back. Get the ass and the colt like I told you. But Jesus, this is better. We all get to ride. I said, an ass and a colt. But Jesus, we did this for you. I said, an ass and a colt. Now take it back and bring the ass and the colt. Now here they are. They're taking the wagon and the oxen back. Number one, they're going to look stupid when they go back to, well, you know, Jesus said, I don't know, I don't know. But I'm just guessing, maybe they might start thinking, you know, I don't get it. You try and do something good for the Son of God, and this is the thanks you get. You know, how come he gets to ride and we don't? I mean, come on, we're tired too. You know, why can't we ride in the wagon? Why can't we all ride in the wagon? I mean, if we're all riding in the wagon, we all sing, you know, Michael, row the boat ashore or something. I don't know, but at least you follow what I'm saying? They thought they're doing that. Now, that didn't actually happen, and we know it, but I'm using this to illustrate. This is the way a lot of people in churches think. And then if their idea gets shut down, boy, watch out. Okay, let's bring it home. Let's say that we have, Sister Rapunzel. And she says, I want to be involved in the church. I want to do something. Oh, Pastor, please, 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 please let me do something in the church. I want to help out. I want to be a blessing to the Lord. Okay. Sister Rapunzel, here's what we want you to do. I want you to be in charge of ordering envelopes. Now, these are the envelopes that I use to mail out my monthly teaching letter. They're called number 10 envelopes. You're going to be in charge of ordering those envelopes. Now, we order them from the XYZ office supply store. So that's where you get them. She said, okay, I can do that, I can do that. And so every month, she orders the envelopes from the XYZ office supply store. Well, then 6 months later, she happens to be in Colossal Club. You know, it's one of those big, giant buildings where you have to have a membership to go shopping and you can buy bulk kind of stuff. So she's in the aisles doing some shopping for her family in Colossal Club. And she looks over and it's like, oh, wait a minute. There are number 10 envelopes. Oh, my goodness. I didn't know they had those. And so she goes over and she looks and it's like, oh my goodness, calculate. Why, that's 40% cheaper. Hey, I know what I'll do. So a few days later, I walk into the office, the room, where the number 10 envelopes are stored, and look over and I see 20 boxes of number 10 envelopes from Colossal Club. Now there's 500 envelopes per box. That's 10,000 envelopes, okay? I look at this and I'm, what in the world? Sister Rapunzel, where'd this come from? Oh, Pastor, you are going to be so happy. I was in Colossal Club the other day, and you know how you put me in charge of getting number 10 envelopes? Well, they had these 40% cheaper than where we've been getting them from that ripoff store down there. And so I ordered these for us, Pastor. Isn't that cool? Huh? Boom. What? Yeah. I said, no, wait a second. You're supposed to order the envelope from the XYZ office supply store. Yeah, but Pastor, it costs so much more over there. These are so much cheaper. That's right, Sister Rapunzel. You're correct. They are cheaper. However, the paper that is used to make those envelopes at Colossal Club is a little bit thicker stock, and it jams up in the printer. We cannot use them. We have to use the envelopes that come from XYZ supply store, office supply. So you're going to have to get those sent back in and get the right envelopes. But Pastor, I got the number 10 envelopes the way you wanted. No, you didn't. You got number 10 envelopes, but I said you had to order them from the XYZ office supply store. Are you following this? Did Sister Rapunzel think she's doing the right thing? Yes, she did. Did she do the right thing? No, she did not. Because she had it in her head, I'll do it this way, I'll be helping the ministry. She didn't help. Now we've got 10,000 envelopes that don't work in the printer. They jam up. By the way, that's a real true story, only I'm the one that bought the cheapo envelope from Colossal Club. And seriously, the thicker stock, they would not feed properly through the printer. So what? We got to pay extra for them. But they work. They work. Anyway, you guys get the idea. Now, in Jude chapter 1, verse 10, it talks about how that these guys, they come up with some of these things, you know, with their natural thinking. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, it talks about how that the things of God cannot be naturally known, or you can't comprehend them by the natural mind. They're spiritually discerned. Okay, now let's think about this. Let's just assume that everything that I teach here at this church is truth.
You mean it may not be?
No, just work with me here, okay? Okay, everything that I preach is truth, 100% truth. Now, when you're gone for any reason at all, doesn't matter, if you are not here for a service, do you go back and listen to that sermon that you missed? Now, don't, please don't.
I do. I don't.
Okay, don't do that, all right? Because if God has put you in this church, and I'm the person that has the primary responsibility of feeding you, and you're not listening to the sermons that you miss when you're not here, are you really in submission? Seriously, are you? No, you're not. Because you see, the way a church is set up, God sends people to that church. Those people are supposed to listen to what's being set before them, you know, the table of the Lord. They're supposed to be feasting from the table of the Lord. Now, if you're not doing that, if you're not going back and listening, then am I really being any true benefit to you? Because that means the only time that I'm a benefit to you is when you're here. You know, these messages that, and this is this truth that I'm sharing with you right now, it's not just this church, it could be any other church. Are you listening to what the under-shepherd to Jesus Christ is delivering? And if you're not, well, why not? But then along with that, how do you know what you believe is true? How do you know it? You know, all I have to do is listen, and I know where people are coming from. And when I hear things said that contradict what is in the Word of God, you're either not paying attention when you're here, or you're not listening to things that you miss when you're gone, and you're not studying to show yourself approved. You know, it's not happening. It's just not happening. You can't come up with your own doctrine and expect God to be in agreement with it. See, think of it from this perspective. You know, people say things, well, I disagree with such and such. I just don't believe that's what that verse means. I just don't believe. Okay, well, ask. Ask me. I'm not going to sit down and spend an hour talking to you. I'll tell you what to look for and what to listen to and what sermons to go back and hear again. Then it's going to be on you to go back and do that. But a lot of people are afraid to go to the pastor. I understand that. I was when I was growing up, you know, just the intimidation thing, I get it. But does that mean that murmuring and complaining and pulling a Korah is right? No. look, you could die an early death through rebellion. And that's not doing you any good. And it's sure not doing the body of Christ any good. You know, another thing to consider, with me being the pastor, would I be out of line to expect those who want to be in service, any kind of ministry service here at this church, would I be out of line to expect, even demand, that they listen to everything that's taught and that they live by scriptural standards? Would I be wrong to do that? Well, the answer is no, I would not. But I can tell you right now, there are some people that are hoping that I don't come down and say, all right, you need to do this. When the truth of the matter is, I might be wrong by not doing it. Why should I not expect you to feast from the table of the Lord? I'm not trying to give anybody a hard time. What I'm trying to do is bring to the forefront how lazy the body of Christ has become in general. And we have fostered this condition of lukewarmness, and a lot of it has to do with the fact that people, okay, I go to a church, we got a pastor, praise God, thank you, Jesus, I'm going to heaven. You know, I'm doing my business here. I'm doing what's right. Okay, well, it's far more than that. Far more than that. This is all set up for our benefit. This is all set up so that we can conform to the glory of Christ. And if we don't do it the way that God has established it in His Word, you know, what can we expect? I'll tell you a story in closing. And I'm not one of these guys that, you know, I have four or five closings. I mean, I'm closing. There was this teenage boy who was injured and had a dislocated knee. That sounds painful. Well, anyway, the doctors and whoever attended, you know, they didn't get it reset properly in the joint. Well, this was a teenage boy and he was still growing. Now, this is a true story. And as he was growing, his uninjured leg was growing normally, but the leg that had been injured stopped growing. Because even though it had been reset, it wasn't reset properly to where all of the nutrients and all of the everything necessary for growth could pass freely through the leg. And so as that kid grew older, that leg was shorter than the other one. And there was nothing they could do about it. It's because they had messed up when they tried to reset the leg and they thought they had done it right, but they hadn't. There are a lot of Christians who are disjointed, like that knee. They think everything is okay. They think that there is this flow of God. See, you can be disjointed and still experience the presence of God in a church service. But as far as what's necessary for the growth and the development to take place, there can be, just like that kid with the dislocated knee, okay, there was pain involved with that, and pain in resetting it. And they tried to go back and fix it, you know, later on, but it just wasn't working right. Well, when you have a dislocated Christian, there can be a lot of pain to get reset properly when it comes to Scripture. There are a lot of Christians who don't realize how much rebellion is operating in their lives. You may disagree, you know, those of you here, those watching, whatever church you go to, you know, you may disagree with your pastor, but the moment you open your mouth and start doing like Korah, you know, you're opening the door for demonic attack in your life. God expects us to respect others. When I get around other people, maybe I meet somebody for the first time, and this person's a pastor, I'll refer to that person as Pastor so-and-so out of respect for who that person is. I don't just buddy up to them. Now, over time, we might end up buddies, but not at first. when you begin to understand this concept of respect and honor and how much God hates pride, and you begin to mortify the pride in your life, guys, I'm telling you, you're going to experience a spiritual breakthrough that is absolutely powerful. Because pride is one thing that's going to hold people back from maturing fully into what God wants them to mature. Okay, now, let me say this again. This message is not directed to a handful of problem makers in this church. That's not going on. If it were, I would know about it. This is a message, number one, if this kind of stuff is going on in you, then you need to correct it. But number two, guard against it in the future. Because I can tell you right now, sooner or later, between now and the time that Jesus comes back, I will probably do something you don't like. In fact, I'm probably doing it today with this sermon. I'll probably do something you don't like. Well, I'm not going to do it on purpose. I'm not going to offend you on purpose. But it's just how it is when people interact with people. So if and when that happens, you know, don't rise up. Don't murmur. You know, pray for me. You know, God, he really upset me. Okay, well, talk to God about it. Other people don't need to know. Talk to God about it. Look, I've had to learn this myself. And in the preparation for this sermon, I actually had to repent for things I said in the past against pastors that I had. It was wrong. It was wrong of me. At the time, I didn't think it was. In fact, at the time, I don't think I was lying. But it was wrong. And I was out of order before God. And even though God, he probably isn't sitting up in heaven, I'm waiting for you to repent for this, I felt the need. And so I did. Guys, we can't let this be a hindrance to what he wants to do in our lives, in this ministry, or for revival. So, talk it over with the Lord, and if there's anything that needs to be corrected, just correct it. And we walk together from this point in full fellowship into the fullness of God's will for this ministry and our lives. Praise the Lord. Go ahead and stand.
I'll stand if I want to. Bless God.
Praise God. Well, Father, I know that for some people this would have been a real challenging message. But I want to lift myself up to you, and Father, if you see me, if there's rebellion in me, show it to me, because I need to repent of it and make it right. And again, I ask you, Father, you know, as I'm standing up here talking about this, I think of something else I did to a pastor. I'm not going to say it publicly. You know what it is, but Father, I apologize for that. I repent. It was wrong. It was wrong of me. I shouldn't have done it. So, Father, I thank you. I thank you for these lessons that I've learned. And I just pray that we all take this to heart and go forward with you. Thank you for it, Father. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, Father, praise God. Amen. Amen. And bless God, folks. By Jesus' stripes, we were healed. I'm going to keep saying that and keep saying that because it's the Word of God and it's true. By Jesus' stripes, we were healed. So listen, as you're leaving tonight, if you have an offering, go ahead and bring it up. Those of you watching, you can send an offering. Our mailing address is there at the website. You can also do it through PayPal. The link is there on the opening page of the website. Thank you for being with us tonight. I appreciate that. You guys have a blessed remainder of this evening. And glory to God, the daylight's getting longer and longer. Isn't that wonderful? Well, I think it's wonderful. All righty. You guys have a blessed evening. We'll see you again.